on the debate tonight. The election commission accused of being biased. Right from the day the chief election commissioner Sunil Arora announced elections spread across seven phases, opposition parties have accused the election commission of bias. Today, as campaigning concluded, once again the opposition has accused the election commission of favouring the BJP.
Election commission ka jo is election mein role raha hai, wo biased raha hai. Narendra Modi jo bhi bolna chahte bol dete hain.
The 2019 elections were marked by record cash seizures, which the opposition claims targeted them. Several videos of malpractices have also emerged. The elections were also marred by violence. In the final phase, violence forced the election commission to curtail campaigning in West Bengal, an action once again questioned by opposition parties.
Why they stopped meeting for us? Our meeting was yesterday. So campaign band kyun kar diya? Pradhan Mantri ekela meeting karega aur koi nahi karega.
The way election commission is working, I am questioning them as a senior politician of this country.
As campaign for Lok Sabha elections 2019 concludes, Mirror now asks, did the election commission fail to do its job? Is the opposition's charge of a biased EC valid? Let's debate.
So it's a very simple question. Has the election commission lost credibility during the course of this election? Because it's not just politicians who've raised the question. We've had instances during the course of this election where we've had retired bureaucrats write to the election commission. We've had veterans of the Army, Navy and the Air Force write to the election commission and the President of India saying not enough is being done. Senior journalists have felt that the election commission has not been prompt enough and has not taken a clear enough stand. In fact, there are new visuals that have surfaced now of malfunctioning and of EVMs and also of severe malpractice where people are voting for other people. But the election commission doesn't seem to be reacting. So it doesn't matter who won or who finally wins this election. Is the truth that the loss will be that of the election commission? On the show with me, Vivek Reddy of the BJP, Sunit Chopra for the CPIM, Mohammed Khan for the Congress, Badshah Sen, senior journalist, so is Rajesh Sundaram. And we have S.K. Mindiretha, former legal advisor to the election commission. Gentlemen, good evening and thank you for joining us. Mohammed Khan, I will give you the opening argument. Do you believe that the election commission is the new caged parrot of 2019?
Absolutely, yes. And let me substantiate that with the following. We moved 11 complaints against the Prime Minister and Mr. Amit Shah to this very same election commission. For 30 days, they did not respond. We had to go to the Supreme Court and ask that please ask them to decide one way or the other. 4 days after that, they gave a clean chit in all 11 of the cases. Now, Ms. D'Souza, please note the distinction. In Sadhvi Pragya's case, they pass a three-page order. In Ajay Singh Bish's case, they pass a two-page order, giving their reasons. These are reasoned orders. But in the case of Mr. Modi and Mr. Amit Shah, not only do they not issue any notice, they gave a two-paragraph order, simply dispensing with the complaint by saying, with the complaints, plural, by saying that we have found no violation of the extant laws. Now, compare this also to Rahul Gandhiji's case. When Rahul Gandhiji's case in Shahdol came up, they immediately issued a notice to us, and we are glad they did, because we gave a 200-page reply saying, look, this is our explanation for the speech. But why don't you apply this exact same standard to the BJP? I'll come quickly to the Bengal argument. We went as part of a multi-party delegation at 4:30 yesterday to the election commission. And we said, Ms. D'Souza, there are videos of BJP leaders inciting people for violence before the incident. There are videos of BJP leaders threatening people that main UP se hunde bula ke aapko pitwaungi agar natija mere favor mein nahi aaya, that I'll bring goons from outside to beat you up. Number three, we have videos of the actual incident which show people proudly wearing BJP shirts and carrying out this devastation. So why is everyone being punished for the fault of a select few? Penalize them. But no, you don't. You give them an extra day to wrap up their two scheduled rallies, but the rest of the parties are penalized. You tell me, is this a level playing field?
A level playing field? I'm going to take that question and I'm going to jump between the politicians and the journalists. So we will create a level playing field. Badshah Sen, good evening. Do you believe a level playing field has been created? Because it is the election commission's job to conduct free and fair elections. Do you believe the EC has been fair in the last 2 months?
Well, Faye, just to answer that in a somewhat more indirect fashion, the Election Commission pleaded helplessness before the Supreme Court last month when a spate of cases were brought before it, you know, about inflammatory Up speeches and so on, basically violations of the Model Code of Conduct. And at that point of time, when the Supreme Court asked, the Election Commission said it had no powers beyond issuing notices, and at the most it could raise a complaint. So the Supreme Court asked the Election Commission at that point of time whether it was toothless and powerless. The Election Commission actually said nothing thereafter. Now, from being toothless and powerless, suddenly, a couple of days ago, it actually showed what kind of legal powers it has. I refer to the decision to curtail the campaign in West Bengal. It suddenly was able to put a brake on the campaigning altogether. You know, it was able to stop all the leaders from talking. Of course, it was courteous enough towards the Prime Minister that it delayed this curtailment. It should have put it in immediate effect. It should have immediately asked for the campaigning to end under those powers. But for some reason, the kind of heightened security problems that the EC had seen was allowed it to wait 24 hours or a little less than 20 hours, allowed the Prime Minister to have his speech, and then it stopped the others from talking. In other words, in the first instance, the Election Commission showed that it did not have a nutcracker. In the second instance, it says it has a steam hammer. So it cannot crack a nut because it has no nutcracker, but it has a steam hammer to shut everybody up when it feels like it. There is a definite odd behavior on the part of the Election Commission. I do believe that it has applied whatever powers it has rather selectively.
Well, Vivek Reddy of the BJP is with us as well. Vivek Reddy, has the Election Commission become the new caged parrot? Is it being selective in its implementation of the Model Code of Conduct? Do you agree with Mr. Sen or you disagree with him?
Definitely not. And in any case, I'm not the spokesperson for the Election Commission. But from what has occurred, the events that have transpired, I think I'd like to point out a few things. First of all, I think Mr. Sen must be aware that you use a steel hammer when you have to use a steel hammer. And you use a nutcracker when you have to use a nutcracker. If you look at the sort of violence that has taken place in Bengal, the sort of slaughter, the sort of murder of democracy, the sort of incidents and violence, the sort of shooting at poll booths, never before witnessed in the history of India. And that it went under the nose of a government which was responsible for rule of law and order. And you have to use the steel hammer for that. Unfortunately, the Election Commission used it too late. This is first. And the question is this. You use the steel hammer. The Election Commission used the steel hammer, which was too little too late. Because you did, they did it after all the events had occurred at the last day. The second issue that is being pointed out is, why didn't it take effect immediately? I mean, what sort of argument is this? Until the date of last date for polling, campaigning, which ends 48 hours prior to the date of polling, from the date of nomination to that date, when it ends 48 hours prior to the polling, every day the campaigning ends at 10 p.m. And it is only on the last day, that is 48 hours day before the date of polling, that it ends at 5 p.m.
Because I will not wait.
This is as per the election law, as understood very clearly by all of us. This is a pre-laid field of rules that are already existing. Now, if the Election Commission wanted to prepone non-campaigning, extend non-campaigning by one more day, all it has said is, you go to the previous day till the last point of campaigning at 10 p.m., which was an already existing time. And it has said...
Mr. Reddy, we understood what the Election Commission was doing. You're wasting the time of the panel. I just want to point out one thing. Mr. Reddy.
The time at 10 p.m.
Mr. Reddy, we're not arguing 5 p.m. or 10 p.m. We are arguing the entire course of the election. From the day the press conference was held and the schedule was announced, there were concerns about the fact that why was the schedule so long? Why were certain states voting in seven phases when there was no need? And from that day to the last day, which is today, those concerns continue. That is my question. Now, let me read this out. This is Mr. Adityanath. the Chief Minister of Uttar Pradesh campaigning in Bengal, which according to you and according to the Election Commission already had its emotions running high and was already facing serious violence for six phases. This is what Mr. Adityanath has said. And I quote, "In the whole country, Durga Puja and Mohram fell on the same day. In UP, officers asked me, should we change the timing of the puja? I said, the timing of the puja will not be changed. If you want, change the timing of the Mohram procession." You don't believe that this is in any way in violation of the code, because the EC hasn't even taken note as of now.
Why is it a violation, Faye? I really don't know why it is a violation.
Right, fair enough. Why is it a violation?
Chief Minister Yogi Adityanath has said
what did he say? Yeah,
why is it a violation?
It's not a violation.
I don't know. I don't know why you feel that this is a violation of the Model Code of Conduct.
Okay, because if I remember correctly, Vivek Reddy, the Model Code of Conduct said something about bringing religion into campaigns. The Model Code of Conduct also said something about bringing the army and the Air Force into campaigns. But
with each other?
Why should we read the Model Code of Conduct anyway?
How does it bring? See, let me tell you one thing, Faye.
Yes,
you can go about appeasing one section of people, changing time for Mohram, but changing time for Durga Puja, keeping time for Mohram.
Mr. Reddy, you're on mirror now.
You keep on playing against two sections till the date of election. And then when the election comes,
Mr. Reddy, you're on mirror now. This is no room. I do not make room and platform for people to start this Hindu-Muslim nonsense on my channel. I make this very clear to you that we do not allow for this sort of Hindu-Muslim, religious and different types of basis divisiveness on this channel. If you want to address the question I have asked you about the Model Code of Conduct, I will read out the code to you. It says very clearly that you cannot bring in religion when you are campaigning.
All right. Please know, they have created this sort of a politics in India.
All right. I'm going to go to the rest of my guests. I will have someone from my team call Mr. Reddy and brief him again on how a debate works. All right. I also want to bring in Mr. S.K. Mindaretha. Mr. Mindaretha, several things have been said and done in this campaign. I know Mr. Chopra. I will come back to you immediately after this. Mr. Mindaretha is the former legal advisor to the Election Commission. From the day the schedule was announced, there was an announcement post the Model Code of Conduct coming into force about the ASAT testing that the Indian government had done, and that announcement was made by the Prime Minister. After that, Balakot and Pulwama and the martyrs were brought into campaign speeches. There have been questions about the treatment and the actions taken by the Election Commission through this entire process, Mr. Mindaretha. Can you reassure the citizens of India that the Election Commission is fair or has been fair?
See, Election Commission has a very, very tough job.
Mm-mm, no doubt.
You will all have to agree. But at the same time, Election Commission cannot just jump to conclusions. Somebody makes some allegation. Election Commission has to look into all facts. They have to gather the evidence. They have to give a notice to the parties, hear them, then take a decision. And of course, we expect that these decisions should be very expeditious. That's all I can say. And now, all those statements which have been referred to by you, they have been taken note of by the Election Commission. They have taken decisions, right or wrong. And if somebody is aggrieved, they have already gone to the Supreme Court. Those things can be tested there. Then I would not like to sit in judgment over what the Election Commission has done in its collective wisdom. Only with regard to this last intervention in the West Bengal, there are certain questions being raised. So far as the legal aspect of this intervention is concerned, I am sure this was within the powers of the Election Commission, and they have rightly invoked the powers of plenary powers under Article 324 to put a stop to whatever was happening in that state, and they have done at least the right thing.
So So I just want to ask you, Mr. Mindiratha, do you agree with the Election Commission pleading before the Supreme Court that it is toothless and powerless and cannot do anything to stop the politicians from saying what they were saying? Would that have been your argument as well if you were still their legal advisor?
What I feel perhaps, the counsel who was appearing before the Honorable Supreme Court, perhaps he was not properly, I would say, briefed.
At a time when India is in such a crucial election and the Election Commission is appearing before Supreme Court and the Chief Justice was on the bench, are you telling me they sent in a counsel without briefing him correctly? How is that okay? So that actually leaves us with two choices then. Either the Election Commission is not fair or it's not efficient, and neither of those two choices are good choices. There is no third choice. And I promised Mr. Chopra I'll give him an opportunity to make his opening
argument.
You don't agree. Okay. Mr. Mindiratha, you don't agree? Go ahead.
I have talked to that counsel also, and I have talked to the persons who are responsible for this legal work in the commission. They also admitted that they were slightly slow in giving the proper instructions to the counsel. And the next day, that particular deficiency was met. And then they took the right decision, and the Supreme Court also expressed its satisfaction with the action which the commission had taken.
All right. Sunil Chopra, is the EC the new caged parrot?
Right. Of course it's the new caged parrot. And it's a new caged parrot which unfortunately has already had the experience of being an independent body. And that is why, as you know, in some of the crucial decisions, the Election Commission had people who disagreed with what the commission was doing. And that was brushed under the carpet. This is terrible. And I find that complaints have come up in almost every state, whether it's Mr. Alagiri in Tamil Nadu, whether it's Mr. Naidu in Andhra, whether it's Tripura, whether it's Mamta in West Bengal, Tejaswi in Bihar, Naveen Patnaik in Orissa, UP, Akhilesh Kumar, Punjab, Rajasthan, JNK, almost everywhere there have been complaints all over the country. So it is not only inefficient, but it has double standards. And I think this has been the worst election that we have ever seen. And this is an election that is going to have a very bad impact on Indian democracy.
Where we are,
because
Vivek
20
Reddy.
Lakh EVMs yes. have disappeared. You read the yes. article in Frontline.
Yes. So Vivek Reddy and Mr. Mindiratha both say no, the Election Commission has been fair. Badshah Sen indirectly says yes, they have been perhaps a little partial. Mohammed Khan and Sunil Chopra, members of the opposition, say the Election Commission has not been fair. Rajesh Sundaram is my tiebreaker. Rajesh Sundaram, what do you agree with? Do you think the Election Commission has created a fair playing field, or has it played on one side?
Well, the Election Commission, like one of your colleagues said earlier in a show, is like a referee in a football match. It's supposed to blow the whistle when it has to. It has to show the yellow card when it has to. And it has to show the red card and take players out when it has to. Clearly, it has failed as a referee. And once a referee's role is in doubt, then the whole game comes into question. So clearly, if you see also what's happening right now, there's no opposition politician who's not accused the Election Commission of bias or a slant, including Mr. Chandrababu Naidu today, who said that the new set of bipoles that have been announced based on the complaint by the YSR Congress, they said uh, it, 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 he did not agree with that. Also, if you see, the BJP spokesperson on your show is defending and is interpreting the election laws to what, you know, the decisions taken by the election commission. So clearly, there are some parties who are absolutely in agreement with the fact that the election commission is doing a good job, and a vast majority of the opposition parties who feel that they're not. So clearly, I think if the referee were conducting the match with equal harshness, against both sides, there are no questions raised. But if there are so many questions raised, there has to be a fire if there's so much smoke.
Absolutely. And I see, okay, we're opening this up for rebuttals now. Vivek Reddy, now you can do your thing. All right, I see Mr. Bindiretta put his hand up. Go ahead, Mr. Bindiretta. You disagree with you. Rajesh.
No, I just want to... No, okay. I just want to say one minute only.
Yes.
What I want to say, that even now we are finding that the referees are taking decision after seeing the replays, and then only they take the decision.
No.
So in this case, if the election commission also wanted to gather all material before taking some decision, they may have taken some time.
Yes, but in this case, Mr. Bindiretta, one side is having to leave the field, run to Supreme Court, and then ask the Supreme Court to tell the referee to look at the replay. A lot of times, the referee is not looking at the replay on its own. All right, Mohammed Khan, go ahead, and Vivek will rebut.
Yes, very quickly, three quick points. First of all, decide for yourself if these statements are offensive. When the Prime Minister says, you picked a constituency where the majority is in a minority, it's lost on no one. Everyone takes it in the spirit he intended. When Mr. Amit Shah says that when a procession is taken out in that constituency, you can't tell if it's India or Pakistan, forgetting that those are his citizens as well. Number three, when the Prime Minister says that when you vote, remember the martyrs of Balakot, does it not violate the circulars of March 9th and March 19th issued by this very election commission? I would also like to point out that others, when they make exactly the same statements like Ajay Singh Bisht or Pragya Thakur, they are penalized by 48-hour to 72-hour suspensions. Why this deviation and variance in standard? Number two, Vivek actually said something quite sensible. He was quoting Section 126 of the Representation of People's Act, and he said that polling has to close 48 hours before, campaigning has to close 48 hours before polling. Well, Vivek, and you put it at 5 p.m., then let me ask you, why did the PM hold his press conference today after 5? Thank you so much for confirming that the press conference today was indeed a violation. Not that I think it will do much good if we take it to the commission, but thank you for putting that before the viewers. Concludingly, I want to say one very important thing. None of the facts that we have presented are statements of opinion. These are backed up by documentation, evidence. They're not even denied by the Prime Minister and Amit Shah. And yet the Election Commission displays a reluctance to take action. Forget take action. Even issue them a notice. Even ask them their side of the story. In this case, and in conclusion, I want to say this. This Election Commission has let down the legacy of great people like T.N. Seshan Saab, Lingdo Saab, who were fearless, who used the powers and art. Even O.P. Rawat Saab, the last election
Allow Vivek to rebut.
Qureshi Saab before that, who's been on this channel several times. They used that power several times. And
Vivek Reddy, don't you think there should be censures passed against Pragya Thakur? Don't you think the Election Commission has been dragging its feet? Your response to Mohammed Khan, go ahead.
Well, I think so far as Pragya Thakur is concerned, the Election Commission has taken decisions. The statements were in the extreme, and they have judged it on the basis of the extreme
from yesterday,
nature
Mr.
of those statements, and have said
she's
all
a
right,
slow learner. She hasn't learned from the previous censures she's received.
Yes. Yesterday also, it has to take action. Yes. All right, it has to take action. I think the Election Commission has to react on these. But what I am referring to is, Faye, look here, what has happened in this election is, you find that the Congress, instead of fighting the real election, is fighting it with the Election Commission. That's the problem. And there is a reason for that. The reason is, the Congress has become so desperate and frustrated that it knows that it has no traction with the people, and it is trying to create these side issues. Now the main issue is, that look here, when the Prime Minister narrates something, when the Prime Minister walks on the booth to up to the polling booth and he walks back, everything is made an issue for complaint. What sort of a opposition party you are? Is there some sort of a balance in the way you think? Everything has to be a complaint, is it? Even a silly thing. And that you ask the Election Commission to decide. Today, Rahul Gandhi went about bragging and saying, Chaukidar chore, chaukidar chore. That complaint is lying with the Election Commission. We did it in the last show, Faye. You know about it. And that is still hanging fire. There is no decision on that. So this is he does not have proof. He does not have evidence. Under the model code of conduct, you cannot talk against a person without proof and evidence. And you go about bragging the whole of India and you don't have that much of...
Allow Mohammed Khan to respond and then I'll bring in the rest of my guests. Mohammed Khan, respond, please.
The other issue is, I have one...
Okay, you have one more. All right, go ahead.
I have 10 seconds.
Vivek.
Let him finish. Vivek,
now the issue is, if we are asking about fairness, the issue is, 1 second, just 10 seconds. Yeah, if you are asking, raising an issue of fairness, Faye, it is very justified. We have to raise the issue of fairness with the Election Commission. It is for the Election Commission to answer. We don't know what sort of proof they have, what sort of documentation they have for the decisions they have been taking, and we are not the persons to defend it. But I'd like to ask you one thing. There is fairness in journalism also. We did 100 shows for the past 100 days. Faye D'Souza did 100 shows, but not even one show did she say. All the shows she went against Modi. Not even one show, Faye, at least. I have the record of all the 100 shows. Not even one show saying, look here, Mr. Modi has done something good for this nation. Hasn't he done any good according to Faye D'Souza? So what is the fairness of journalism we are looking at?
What is the topic of discussion we are looking at?
We are entitled to ask it.
So you ask your questions, I'll ask my questions.
You are going to argumentum ad hominem,
so we need to have,
which is the cheapest form of losing an argument.
We need to judge you also.
You know, Vivek Reddy, I gave you extra time to finish your argument, but you started arguing a completely different thing. My only response... All right, Vivek Reddy, let me just bring the others in. My only response is this.
Can I respond to
honest observation?
Yes. But he has... Mohammed Khan, he has asked me questions about my work. And Vivek Reddy, it's completely within your rights to ask questions about my work, just like I will ask questions about your work. Now, if we are going to completely deviate and have random discussions, I would be tempted to ask you why the Prime Minister feels he will never personally forgive Pragya Thakur for saying what she did about Mahatma Gandhi, but the BJP has taken zero action against her. She is still your candidate and she's still a card-holding member of your party. If the BJP was truly upset in any way, they would expel her from the party and make her an independent candidate. But you're not going to do it. Everything is lip service. So don't ask me about my job before you have answers about your own job. Mohammed Khan, your response, and then I want to bring in the rest of my guests. I've already given you a chance. Yeah, you
Vivek,
wasted that chance.
Vivek, yes, my answer is this. First of all, Vivek, can you name one example, just one, of any candidate out of the 543, actually there are several times 543, who carried out a rally on the day he or she cast his vote? Cast the vote, carried out an extensive rally, replete with flags and posters and slogans and banners in a premeditated and orchestrated fashion, in this fashion. We complained to the Election Commission. It took no action. We gave them advance notice that the Prime Minister is going to do this on the day of polling. No action, Vivek. Show me one other candidate who's done this. Number two, Vivek, I would also urge you that if you find
He's
something wrong, go to the Election Commission. You have several times.
Mr.
You have taken action.
Khan,
and finally,
out of your mind?
No, no.
He's walking to
a
the
several kilometer
How
walk.
Silly can the
a several
become?
Kilometer
how
walk.
Silly, how childish
Vivek,
you
listen
can
to
become.
Me.
He's
Vivek,
walking
Vivek,
to the police
can I conclude?
Station.
Vivek,
no, Mr. Reddy, do not interrupt.
Vivek, no
we had this conversation
you.
Before.
Vivek,
is
no one interrupted
violation
you.
Of model code of conduct?
Vivek,
can't
no
you
one
go
interrupted
and get a better
you.
Case?
Let me just conclude.
My dear
First
sir,
of all, it was not innocuous.
Can't you go and get a better case?
Vivek,
please.
It was not
the
innocuous.
BJP doesn't
we have
let
the video,
anyone else
have the
speak.
Images. You know that campaign activity is prohibited.
Forgive me. To the politicians, I'm going to take this question now. One second. I'm going to take this question now to Badshah Sen. Badshah Sen, the reason why I'm asking you this question, Badshah Sen, is because Vivek Reddy has raised a question about whether or not I'm biased while we are talking about the Election Commission. For our viewers, this is a classic case of changing the goalpost and distracting the conversation. Now, I just want to point out that Badshah Sen has been part of several discussions we've had on the election on this channel, and he can testify to whether or not I've been biased. But also, Vivek Reddy claims to have a record of all of my shows. He's doing this in an attempt to intimidate me, to think that he is tracking my work. I'm very happy to have him track my work because I believe we do very good work on this channel. We've also raised questions to the Aam Aadmi Party government about the state of affairs in Delhi. We've raised questions to the TDP government and the Telangana government about the education problem that they're having in Telangana right now. We've raised questions to the Naveen Patnaik government in Odisha about the state of affairs post the cyclone and whether or not they've managed to provide water and electricity to their people. We've raised questions in Karnataka, in Rajasthan, in Madhya Pradesh about the safety for women on various issues. Obviously, Vivek Reddy is not doing a very good job of tracking. People see what they want to see. I am very proud of the work we do on this channel, and I'm open to questions on what we do, and I'm happy to answer any questions. But Badshah Sen, it doesn't change the fact that the question that we've asked today remains unanswered. Is the EC a caged parrot? And the way the BJP is vehemently defending the EC almost seems like they're playing on the same team.
After that encounter between Vivek Reddy and you, Faye, I am constrained to say that I do believe that the Election Commission is a caged parrot. I'd better be very specific about this because I've had a run-in with this chap. I think last night on Tanvi's show, he ranted and raved, and I realized that I should keep my cool. He's a young guy. He'll learn later on in life. But at this moment of time, he really shoots off the mouth. He goes off kilter. He starts questioning people's definitions and of words, nutcracker, this, that, the other. He has no clue about anything. I wish him well, however. And I'd like to say, Faye, you don't need me
to give
you a good certificate.
That is because questions were uncomfortable to you.
I do believe this is a good program. Now, can you tell him to shut up, Faye? Please.
Yep. All right. Go ahead. Badshah Sen, go ahead.
I'm quite okay with that. Yeah. Okay. So the point I'm making is that we don't need a certificate from the likes of Mr. Reddy. He has not been able to answer any of the questions that have been raised against the EC. He's turning personal. He has said nothing about the EC. In fact, it would be great if he got up and said the EC is great. It's wonderful. Because a few days ago on your program, I remember, the BJP was complaining about the bias of the EC. So if the BJP has already complained about it, then he's defending the EC. It's strange. These guys are talking in contradictory terms. I mean, on the one hand, they say EC is fine. On the other hand, they say EC is not fine. They were shouting about the EC in West Bengal till the EC clamped down. Until then, the EC was bad. Now it's very good. The point also means that the EC is behaving in mysterious fashions. It's probably too late now to raise this issue. I was planning to do so. I'm really mystified as to why it transferred out the Home Secretary and the ADG of police in West Bengal. It may not be, people may not remember that Mamata Banerjee defended the ADG of police, Rajiv Kumar, in February this year when the CBI was sent mysteriously to raid his house. The same Rajiv Kumar, Mamata Banerjee sat to defend her own police officers while there was an assault from that other cage parrot, the CBI, to try and find out. And the mystery behind that is simple. At the moment, one of the key strategists of the BJP campaign in West Bengal is one Mr. Mukul Roy, former vice president, if I'm not mistaken, of the Trinamool Congress and a henchman of Mamata in those days. He's now masterminding or running, helping the BJP run its campaign in West Bengal. Rajiv Kumar was investigating Mr. Mukul Roy. Mr. Mukul Roy and Hemanta Biswa Sarma in Assam were part of the accused in those chit fund scams. Mysteriously, the CBI has dropped those cases. Mysteriously, Rajiv Kumar has been transferred from West Bengal to report to the Home Ministry in the centre. All of this being done by the CPI, by the Election Commission, not by any other official. Why has the Election Commission transferred this gentleman? This Rajiv Kumar had the night before the end of the campaigning, before the election, he had arrested one BJP leader who was living there in a hotel. He's from outside, who was believed to be part of the people in that violent scenes where Vidya Sagar's statue was destroyed. Rajiv Kumar's been transferred. I don't know what happened to Mr. Bagga of the BJP, who was originally arrested by Rajiv Kumar. These are mysterious things that are happening, and this Election Commission, or rather I should call it the Election Omission, is taking part in such things. They're transferring officers who are trying to do their job.
Well, this is... Okay, all right. So now... You've pushed Badshah Sen over the edge, and he's called the Election Commission the Election Omission. But I do want to bring in the rest of us. Sunil Chopra had a point to make. Mr. Chopra, go ahead.
point is that this election commission and the CBI and the ED and the Prime Minister and the BJP President, they have contributed to making this one of the worst elections we have ever seen in India. And I hope such a thing is never repeated again. And the people of India will make sure not only that they are defeated now, they will make sure that they will never come back to power again.
It's, you know, we have a lot of questions that are coming. One question from our viewers, one question that really concerns me, Rajesh, I'll bring this to you. We have Wajid Ali who's asked us, is this what elections will always be like? Is this now, is this the new bar for the election commission? Will we always have elections like this? And what does this mean for our democracy? How do I as a citizen then trust the outcome of the election if I don't know whether or not the election commission has been 100% fair?
Well, I think it is an issue of individuals. As far as the system is concerned, you had people like Mr. Seshan who used the same system to cleanse it. So I think if there are, you know, if there is, I'm not saying that this is there's any politics in the appointments, but if there is a political will to keep away politics from the appointment two positions to constitutional bodies, I think till the time that happens, this will happen. But I think it's an individual issue. It would not be a systemic issue. And it's clearly, if we have people with a much better track record who are given a fair amount of autonomy, there is enough provision in the constitutional body for them to take tough action to make sure that, and they have the resources and the powers well within their reach to make sure that the elections are conducted fairly, peacefully. So I don't think this is something that's a permanent a situation, but of course it takes a political wing and to totally disconnect the politics from the constitutional body, which I think has got a little mixed up somewhere.
Let me just remind our viewers of all of the various reasons the election commission was brought into question. First of all, when they announced the schedule, there were parties who said that the schedule was too long. There was no explanation for why some states like West Bengal, for example, were voting in seven phases, far smaller states were voting in only two phases. Post that, there was the ASAT announcement of the fact that we can shoot down satellites on our own. That announcement was made by the Prime Minister after the code of conduct came into play. We've had 66 bureaucrats who wrote to the President and they raised some very serious questions. We've had retired army officers who've written to the President. Namo TV was brought into question. There was the film that was released. There were two films. Mamata Banerjee had a film as well that was brought into question. There was a series and there was a television channel. There were various speeches in which the Army and the Air Force were brought into election speeches and credit was taken for their work in Balakot and credit was taken for their sacrifice in Pulwama. We've had rape being made into an election panel, an election point as well. And a fair question that Vivek Reddy raised is, Mohammed Khan, the question of Rahul Gandhi having to apologize to the Supreme Court for the term Chaukidar Chorhead. He attributed that to the Supreme Court in an election speech. That's pending before the Election Commission as well. So let's not behave that it's only the BJP's fault to have brought this down to the level that it is at.
Well,
right
actually,
now.
Mr. Reddy is, yes. Mr. Reddy seems to be ill-informed about what transpired in the Supreme Court. We were there, so we know. Mr. Mukul Rohtagi, your senior counsel, did bring this to the attention of the Supreme Court that we are using the slogan Chaukidar Chor Hai. He in fact repeatedly urged the Supreme Court to take note of that. The Supreme Court did not, the Chief Justice did not, because this is the language of politics, this is the language of our campaign and we stand by it. You in fact raised this before the Election Commission as well. You got an ad struck down in Madhya Pradesh which carried the tagline Chaukidar Chor Hai. But guess what, Vivek, it became an organic slogan and that is something you can't stop. We haven't used it in any of our campaign materials as a result of that intervention. So please do your homework before you come here. The second thing is, you're questioning Faye very intently and with a great degree of vehemence, forgetting that you represent a party that is elected to office in a democracy and must necessarily answer questions. I don't blame you because you're the highest leader is comfortable asking questions about how he eats mangoes and whether he knows how to cook rotis or not. That, of course, a spokesperson like you would also be petrified. But remember this, as your term comes to an end, there, when you're in government, you have a higher responsibility. You can't turn around, make ad hominem attacks and say, nahin, main toh jawab nahin dunga. Aap apni jawab dijiye ki agar aap national hai ya anti-national. This is what will get you out of power on the 23rd.
Well, I just want to bring Vivek Reddy back to respond to that. And Vivek Reddy, before you respond, I just want to give you my response as well.
Can I come in, Faye?
Yes, one second. You did say, of course, that I don't say anything good, that this person has done this good and that person has done this good. That is not my job. My job is to raise questions about things that are not being done right. To talk about what someone has done good, that is public relations and advertising, something that your party does very, very well. That is a different profession. I'm a journalist. Mine is a different profession. Mine is a profession to speak on behalf of those who are facing injustice, lack of water, lack of clean air, lack of social justice. And of course, they're not safe in their schools and in their homes and in their fields at this point. That is my job. I am not a PR person and I'm not an advertising executive. Now, you may, if you please, respond to Mohammed Khan. Go ahead.
Yes. Let me tell you, Faye, I don't want to, at the beginning of my rebuttal, I don't want to get into your issues. I will come back to that. I will raise that issue also. First of all, Mr. Mohammed Khan must understand that the proceedings, whatever has taken place in the Supreme Court, was with respect to certain name-calling. And the Election Commission has put down and said, there is no name-calling. Well, we are saying, the Congress is saying, and some of the panelists are saying that this is unfair. The issue is that if you are saying name-calling is unfair, name-calling is wrong, it is a violation of Model Code of Conduct, Mohammed Khan, then Chaukidar Chore is also unfair. It's also name-calling. It cannot be sustained. So you have to see, you may be in a political party. I may be in a political party, but at least we need to weigh the scales equally and say, look here, this is where fairness is. But unfortunately, the Congress wants to say the name calling is bad by certain persons, but their name calling has nothing to do with it. There is no problem. This is one. The second issue is, don't try to make predictions, Mohammed Khan. This is the judgment of the people which we are waiting for on 23rd. Whatever is the judgment of the people, we will have to take. Don't try to be impetuous in trying to make predictions and say that you are on your way out. The people will decide. Be calm. 5 days is not much. The people will decide. The people will show upon whom they should bestow their confidence and as to who should take this country forward. People also know who is competent and who can take them forward in this country. So it is for them to decide. It is in the honest judgment that it is in their honest judgment that we shape our future. So let us wait for that. It is the common will of the people that has ultimately got to decide.
Can I just say one thing to Vivek? Can I just say one thing to Vivek?
You have raised several social issues. I agree. No, hold on, please.
Are we
hold
back
on.
To don't, me don't now? Try to I interrupt. Thought I settled
you
this.
You can get your chance later. I have seen many of your shows. Yes, yes.
I think I, you ought to I stop the monologue.
You have taken women's issues. You have taken various social issues. But my question is, Faye,
yes.
When you may not want to adopt a position in favor of Modi, you may not want to adopt a position in favor of any political party, but I see that every issue you take every day at 9 o'clock is an issue that is against Modi. And I don't know why you have that visceral dislike. That
Mr.
is the problem
Reddy?
Here.
Mr. Reddy?
See, whenever you're biased, it is very easy to say you're biased. I could just say, look, your Faye is biased. And because she takes all this, this is all seen so flatly, so clearly. It is so transparent.
All right.
I mean,
Mr.
you
Reddy.
Don't need, even a layman can say. Many of my friends say, why is Faye anti-Modi?
Well, your friends should
so this
read
is
a
where
book.
It, this is
okay.
where it is.
Mr. Reddy, if
you're
done,
the man who sees the
you
television.
Have to wait for my response.
You don't have to judge yourself. You
wait
have to ask
response,
the man
sir?
Who sees the television and say, look here, this is where I am.
All right. Are you
yes.
done? All right. Here's my response and I'm going to give you my response one last time. All right. Are you listening? Are you listening carefully? Yes. When you have one party.
No, you don't have to give the response. This is my opinion. It is your
this
opinion.
This is typical,
to
of course, that he doesn't want to hear the response. Now,
but
when
I
you have one
you,
party that runs the central government
Please
and several
Please
state governments, which you, for your party yourself, are very, very proud of, and several cities, including the one that I live in, when we raise questions about these states and about central government policies, your party has to respond. This is what happens when you are in power in so many different states. Now, when we raise questions about Delhi, which we have, we bring into question the Aam Aadmi Party. In Karnataka, it's the JDS Congress. In Chennai, it's the AIADMK. In Hyderabad, it is the Hyderabad government and the TRS. In Bengal, it is Mamata Banerjee and her government and the TMC. In Odisha, it's Navin Patnaik and his government. And we have raised questions in every single state. Now, if you are at this point running the most number of states and the most number of cities in the municipal corporation and the country, invariably, very often the questions will be directed to you. That is what Spider-Man meant when he said, with great power comes great responsibility. Nobody. So if you're not comfortable please answering the questions, don't answer the questions. But that please is the last time I'm going to have to justify simple journalism to you. All right, let's move on now, and I'm going to go back to Rajesh Sundaram. Rajesh Sundaram.
This is not simple journalism. This is one-sidedness.
Is this what our country is going to look like, Rajesh Sundaram? Is this what discourse is going to sound like for the rest of our adult voting lives? Because this would be terribly disappointing.
See, about people questioning people's patriotism and their journalism. I think this is something which I find very funny. You know, like you said, the job of the journalist is to ask questions to power, and that's what they're doing. Right. They have 90% of the stations out there who are doing
Sir,
the.
Are they beyond question?
Who's beyond
None
question?
None of us are beyond question.
You are asking questions.
None of
you
are
asking questions.
Question.
She's answering those questions. But what I'm saying is that you have 90% of the stations today who are towing the government line, who are called Godi Media, not by me or you, but by the government in general. And I am proud that I watch Mirror now at home, because it's one of the few stations which shows a mirror to the people in power, which is what journalism is supposed to be. It is sad now that a vast majority, and you know how it has been done, you know how the media barons have been manipulated into doing this, you know how journalists who raised those questions have lost their jobs, editors have been shifted overnight, all of that has happened, you know, the people know about it. So let's not even go there, you know. Am I a journalist? Am I patriotic? Am I an Indian? All of those things are questions that I will answer myself. You know, the BJP will have to answer questions, or whoever is in government, whichever party is in government, will have to answer questions about their conduct, because you're accountable in a democracy to the people. The media will ask questions. That's their job. If some media is not asking questions, Absolutely. That's a PR agency. That's not a media. And I think this is a television station which is doing true journalism. I mean, I would definitely look at that, you know, as a journalist for the last 25 years.
Bacha Sen, closing arguments.
Yeah. Sorry, I couldn't hear you.
Closing arguments, yeah. Bacha Sen.
No, Faye, I don't think we... okay, closing arguments. I don't think we need to bother about this peculiar situation where we had an anchor versus one of the party spokesmen. This is a new thing for me. The closing arguments from my side is simple. I think at the end of this election process, of course, it still hasn't ended. We still have counting to go on and we still have a round of voting on the 19th. But it's coming to an end, and the election commission, which is what we were focused on. We were not focused on discussing the rights and wrongs of the BJP or that of the Congress or whatever it is. We were focused on what and how the election commission did its work. And frankly speaking, it did its work in a most erratic fashion, to say the least. And in fact, in an extremely unbalanced fashion, to say the worst. It started off saying it can't do anything with even small individual misdemeanors. All right. And thereby the Supreme Court asked, whether are you toothless, are you powerless, and so on. It then ended up by taking a decision to curtail a campaign when it was itself in charge of that, all the supervision of that campaign. They had central security forces, the local police were left out, And this election commission clearly had untrammeled powers to run that. And then suddenly they say there's fear psychosis. So we have to bring this campaign to an end earlier than before. If there's fear psychosis, if there's a fear that something is likely to happen, why was Narendra Modi's campaign allowed at all? Because it could be in danger of facing violence. Imagine the Prime Minister of India facing some apocalyptic action there, some violence taking place. It should have cut short the election even earlier, saying we fear for the safety of the Prime Minister and he should not carry on with his rally, because it was in charge of the law and order in West Bengal, in Calcutta. All it still is. Why did it wait for those extra hours, even under the apprehension that the PM may be attacked, to allow that, and then they decide to shut it up? I am saying this is an unbalanced way in which the Election Commission behaved. There is no question of, 10 o'clock is the last time. If you're cutting short an election, you don't have to observe those niceties. Yes. 10 o'clock is the last day of campaigning and so on. That's not any longer, if there's a risk of enormous violence, if there's a threat to the lives of our leaders, you should cut short the election campaign altogether. Why allow it up to a point? That is the question which it has failed to answer.
Well, it's a very, very valid question, and we're going to leave this here now because we've run out of time. In conclusion, to my panelists and to my audience, I'm simply going to say this. When the Election Commission's decisions and actions, or the lack of decisions and actions, get brought into question, democracy is under threat. And we've had to have these conversations so many times over the last 2 months since the code was brought into force. At the end of the day, if there is smoke, there must be a fire. Setting that aside, in response again to Vivek Reddy's accusing us of being anti this or anti that, I do want to point out, and everything we do is open for you to see. We're on national television, so we're actually not hiding anything. Also, you can take a look at responses that we receive on Twitter. When we question the Congress on Amritsar's train tragedy or rapes in Rajasthan, they accuse us of being biased. When we question the Aam Aadmi Party about air pollution in Delhi, they accused us of being biased. When we question the AIADMK about situations in Tuticorin and other parts of Tamil Nadu, they accused us of being biased. Calling a journalist biased is the easiest way to attempt to discredit the question they are asking. It's because politicians don't want to answer those questions. As an audience, really, you have in your hand a remote control. You get to vote with your feet. You get to decide if what you are listening to, what you are watching, what you are reading and what you are consuming is in fact fair and unbiased, or is it bought out or sold to one side. Vote with your remote control. Decide what you want to watch and what you will in fact patronize. Your viewership, your readership, your listenership will keep the right channels, the right newspapers, the right magazines in business, and will drive those who are not doing a good job out of business. Thanks for watching.